Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Astronomy Department cycle of seminars. Thanks for joining us here or through our YouTube channel. And today we are very pleased to have with us Dr. Dimitri Gadotti. Many thanks, Dimitri, for accepting our invitation and being here today presenting your work. And I am going to briefly introduce Dimitri. He obtained his PhD degree here at the IAG under the supervision of Professor Ronaldo de Sousa. And after, he was a postdoc at LAM in Marseille and MPA in Garching. And he has been working at the European Southern Observatory since 2009. And next year, Dr. Gadotti will start as assistant professor at the University of Durham in England. And today, Dimitri is going to talk about nuclear disks in external galaxies and the Milky Way, building bulges without merger. So please turn off your microphones and your cameras during the talk. And if you have a question, you can raise here your digital hand in Google Meet, or you can write it down in the YouTube chat and we will ask the speaker later, and the questions will be asked after the presentation. So Dimitri, whenever you're ready, you can start sharing your screen.
Thank you, and thanks everyone for coming. It's a pleasure to be giving this talk at IAG, even though it's not in person. I just realized that my last talk at IAG was in 2012, so there are quite a few new things to tell you. I'm sharing my screen now, and I think you can see everything all right, right?
Yes, yes.
So what I'm going to present to you today is the result of a collaboration called the TIMER collaboration, and this was published in two recent papers last year. And this is about nuclear disks in external galaxies and also in the Milky Way. I'm going to also put this work in the context of other works that been done with the Milky Way galaxy. So let's start with the Milky Way. And first of all, let me establish that the Milky Way is a barred galaxy. You can see this diagram on the left here. Of course, it's a diagram of the Milky Way, but it's based on real data. And the bar is this elongated structure that crosses the center of the galaxy. And it forms due to gravitational instabilities, dynamic instabilities in the disks of stars in the galaxy. Basically, stars start to move in more elongated orbits, which creates this structure here. So the fact that the Milky Way is a barred galaxy is actually known since the 90s. Bini and collaborators in 1991 presented a paper where they studied the kinematics of cold molecular gas in the Milky Way, and they figured out that the best way or the simplest way to explain the kinematics of this gas was to include a non-axisymmetric potential in the potential of the Milky Way, which is basically this elongated bar here. And a few years later, the COBE satellite also published this image, which in fact was an astronomy picture of the day in 1995. And this is an image in the infrared of the Milky Way, where you can see this elongated structure in the center, which is basically the bar seen at an edge-on projection. And in fact, you can even see that this rectangular structure is asymmetric in the sense that the left side is a little bit thicker than the right side. And this is because of a projection effect, because we are seeing the bar at an angle. In fact, if you look back at the left panel here, this is the position of the sun, and we are seeing the bar at an angle. So this side here is closer to the sun, which is this side here. So it appears bigger in the sky. And bars are present in the majority of these galaxies. So the typical number is about 2/3 of these galaxies have bars, but there are some studies that report a fraction of 80% of these galaxies with bars in the infrared, for example. And we also know that the fraction of barred galaxies decrease with redshift. So in this panel here on the top, you can see the total bar fraction as a function of the mass of the galaxy. This other panel is similar, but only including strong bars. So this includes all the bars. And these three lines are for different redshift beams, which you can see here. So this is the highest redshift, the intermediate redshift, and the local galaxy. So you can see that the fraction of bars increase when you get closer to redshift zero. So the fraction of bars decreases with redshift, but it doesn't decrease homogeneously. You can see that it decreases more for the less massive galaxies. So in fact, for more massive galaxies, even at higher redshift, you have a fraction which is almost 50% already. So this is what's been called the downsizing in the bar formation picture, in which bars basically form first in the most massive galaxies. So in the most massive galaxies, they will form earlier on at higher redshifts. And then for least massive galaxies, they will form closer to redshift zero. And this is just for you to have a look at some of the bars that are found in redshift even two. So this is a paper from the Galaxy Zoo collaboration. And you can see basically here the decline in the bar fraction with redshift. And this study push the limit beyond redshift one, and so it's looking at redshift two, and basically the fraction of strong bars at these redshifts is of the order of 10%. This is a very difficult study, right? This is all very tentative, but this is what they get. And you can see here, for example, in this bottom two rows here, this is a selection of barred galaxies from the Galaxy Zoo at different redshifts, and these are unbarred galaxies. So you can see that the most distant barred galaxy found so far at redshift two is this candidate here, which has a bar elongated in this direction. You might find that this is a bit tentative, but if you look at this galaxy here, this clearly shows a strong bar, and even a grand design typical of barred galaxies closer to redshift zero, and this is at redshift 1.3. So there are barred galaxies at higher redshifts, higher than one. And I suspect that with better telescopes and instrumentation, this is going to be seen even more often. So bars are not only important because they are present in the majority of these galaxies, but they are important because they drive important evolutionary processes in these galaxies. And you can see some input from numerical simulations about this. So this is three snapshots from one idealized simulation that contains only stars. So this is the disk seen face on and edge on. This is at the beginning of the simulation, and this is a pure disk of stars. You start the simulation with nothing else, just the disk. And you see that in less than a giga year, so in 700 mega years, the bar develops spontaneously by itself because of this gravitational instability in the disk. And it remains there for until the end of the simulation, which corresponds to over 4 giga years. So bars are robust structures that stay there in the disk, and it can only be destroyed typically in a very violent merger. So one thing that you can see to understand the effect of a bar in a galaxy is if you look at a pure disk of stars without a bar, you can see that all the gravitational forces in the disk are typically radial. There are no tangential forces because this is a purely axisymmetric potential. When you introduce the bar, when the bar develops, you basically have a non-axisymmetric component of the potential, which is the bar, and therefore you create tangential forces in the gas and in the stars in the disk, and this will have profound effects on the evolution of the galaxy. One of the things that happens is that the disk expands. Stars within the bar radius lose angular momentum, and stars that are outside the bar radius will gain angular momentum. So this causes an expansion of the disk, and also the central concentration of mass increases. You can even see in this simulation. And this happens because basically, as a gravitational system, the galaxy wants to achieve a state of minimum energy. And so this is similar to what happened in globular clusters, for example, when you see mass aggregation of stars. So the more massive stars sink closer to the center, and the globular cluster puffs up a little bit with the lighter stars. So basically it's the same process that is happening here, but in galaxies, in these galaxies, this is driven by the bar. What happens to the gas in a disk when the bar forms? So this is seen here in another simulation, a hydrodynamical simulation. And what you're seeing here is the density of the gas. So whiter shades corresponds to higher density. The bar is elongated along the x-axis, and it's rotating counterclockwise. So you can see that along the leading edges of the bar, the gas accumulates and shocks, and this makes the gas lose angular momentum and funnels down to the central region, which you can see here, more or less in a ring-like shape, where it accumulates. Presumably, this gas will originate stars, and this is something that we're gonna see in a minute. Another thing that happens during the evolution of the bar is that the inner part of the bar evolves away from the plane of the disk. So the inner part of the bar grows from the plane of the disk, because when the bar forms, it basically is as thin vertically as the disk, but the inner part evolves away from the disk and creates a structure which you can see here. So this is another simulation with the galaxy face on. Here the galaxy is edge on, but the bar is seen on its side, so what we call the side-on projection. So you can see this rectangular shape, which is actually what I mentioned before in the Kobe image of the Milky Way. And it's seen in other galaxies as well. Sometimes this shape will be more rectangular, depending on the projection. Sometimes it will have this X or peanut shape, as you can see here. So this box peanuts, as they are called, is basically just the inner part of the bar that grows away from the plane of the disk. And incidentally, if the bar is seen end on, so if the bar is along the line of sight, along your line of sight, so basically you see the bar like this, which can be confused with a spheroid, which you only notice that it's not a spheroid if you have kinematic information. So this can create a lot of misinterpretation in the properties of a galaxy. So what about observations? So in observations, we actually see the pile up of gas along the leading edges of the bar. This is a AGST image of a nearby galaxy that is rotating clockwise. So the bar is this structure here. And you can see what I mentioned before in the simulation. So the gas is piling up at the leading edges of the bar, and we can measure, in fact, the inflow of gas towards the central region. And where it accumulates, you see kind of a bluish stellar structure, which presumably could be a structure that is being formed by the gas that is being brought to the center. In fact, there is evidence that the central concentration of gas in barred galaxies is higher than in unbarred galaxies. So this is a plot from Sakamoto et al. In 1999. This is the surface density of molecular gas within 500 parsecs from the center, as a function of the surface density of molecular gas in basically in the whole galaxy. So these lines here are lines of central concentration, and the further you go to the top left of the panel, the higher is the central concentration. And here is a sample of galaxies, and the filled squares are barred galaxies, the empty squares are unbarred galaxies. So you can see clearly that barred galaxies have a higher central concentration of molecular gas, which is in agreement with this picture where the bar is pushing gas to the center. This has also been corroborated by other more recent studies. So what happens to this gas? So as I said, it presumably forms stars. And in fact, there is this paper using SDSS data from Sara Ellison and collaborators, where they show here what they call the excess of star formation rate. So they measure the star formation rate at the center of the galaxies using the SDSS fiber. For a sample of barred and unbarred galaxies, and they compare for different bins of stellar mass for the galaxy if the barred galaxy has a higher star formation rate than the unbarred galaxy. So this axis here, what's plotted in the y-axis, is basically how much more or less star formation rate there is in a barred galaxy as compared to an unbarred galaxy of the same mass. So when we are at lower mass regime, there is no difference between barred and unbarred galaxies, but when you reach higher masses, then there's a systematic difference in the sense that barred galaxies are forming more stars in the central region, again, because of this gas pushing, the bar pushing gas to the center. In a other paper the same year with Paulo Coelho, we actually looked at this, but not in terms of the instantaneous star formations or the star formation rate, but in terms of the star formation history in the central region of galaxies. So basically, we looked at the ages of stars in barred and unbarred galaxies in the bulge, in the central region of the galaxy. So here we are showing the distribution of mean stellar ages for bulges of barred and unbarred galaxies. So in red is bars, in black in barred galaxies. No, sorry, in red is barred galaxies, in black without bars. And these are three different beams of bulge mass. So again, we see that for lower bulge masses, there's no difference between barred and unbarred galaxies. But when you reach higher masses, you see that the distributions become quite different, and the barred galaxies show an excess of younger stars in the central region. So again, in agreement with this picture that I'm describing now. So if we take a step back now, then it seems that we have a sort of dichotomy in the central structures that you can find in this galaxy. So the classical picture is the one that I'm showing here on the left, where the central region is dominated by a spheroid that has hot kinematics. So the stars are moving with a lot of random motions, and there are older stars, and typically, so this is what is called the classical bulge, and typically you expect that these are built in violent processes such as mergers or also the coalescence of disk clumps at a high redshift. But I've been telling you that bars can push gas to the center, and they look like they are forming something in the center that could be a different stellar structure forming a different process as compared to the classical bulge. So this could be, and this is something that we set out to do, this could be what's been called the pseudo bulge, the exponential bulge that is found in photometric studies, which are different from the classical bulge that have a more concentrated light profile, not an exponential light profile. So we wanted to test if these structures are formed by the bar, and if they really are the what people call the pseudo bulges or disc-like bulges or disky bulges in the photometric decompositions, if they show as exponential profiles. So if they are built by the bar, then we expect that they should be kinematically cold, because basically what happens is that the gas accumulates in the central region, and the orbital structure of the bar in the central region promotes the formation of stars in circular orbit. So it should be a kinematically cold structure, which contrasts with the kinematically hot classical bulge. So we wanted to test this, but we also wanted to study these nuclear disks, because they hold clues, important clues for the formation and evolution of galaxies. Because if they really were formed by the bar, then we can, first of all, tell the age of the bar, because the oldest stars in this structure here will be built when the bar just formed, pushed gas to the center, and formed stars here in this structure for the first time. So we can have a measure, a lower limit for the bar age if we study the star formation history of this structure here. It can also tell us the gas accretion rate of the galaxy, because every time basically that there is gas falling in the disk within the bar radius, that this gas will be pushed to the center and will form new stars here. So if you study again the star formation history of this structure, you can have different peaks in the star formation history, and each peak will correspond to a gas accretion event. And they can also tell us a bit about the merger history of the galaxy, because these structures can be destroyed if there is a massive merger. So the fact that we can see these in this galaxy, for example, means that that this galaxy must have a relatively quiet merger history, or at least that the mergers did not affect the central part of the galaxy. So in fact, in a pilot study with one galaxy we published in 2015, we measured the age of the bar for one galaxy, NGC 4371, and we found that it's about 10 giga-years. So it's a very old bar, very robust bar, which corresponds more or less to redshift 1.8, which is in same ballpark of this highest redshift galaxies that I mentioned before. So it's also interesting to see this archaeological evidence for bars being formed at redshift 2. So we wanted to do this with a larger sample of galaxies, not with one galaxy only that we did in the pilot project. So this we started then the TIMER project, which is which stands for Time Inference with MUSE in Astrogalactic Rings. This is done with the MUSE spectrograph on the VOT, the MUSE IFU spectrograph, right? So it is an integral field unit that has a quite large field of view, so it's 1 arc minute square. It has a very good spatial sampling, so the spaxels are only 2 arc seconds in size, which is fundamental for the kind of study that we are doing. And basically, you get almost 100,000 spectra per pointing. So it's really like for every pixel on the image, you get a spectrum, and there's a lot of stuff that you can study from the spectrum because it covers basically the whole optical range. It doesn't go so much to the blue, which sometimes causes some difficulties, but basically is the whole optical range, and it at a resolution that is good enough for the studies of, you know, galaxies basically. So we did this survey with we observed 24 nearby barred galaxies, and we selected these galaxies basically to have bars, but also to have structures in the center that morphologically, visually, resemble some kind of disc-like structure. So there could be these structures being built by the bar. But this is only a morphological selection, right? So to test really if they are disks, we need to measure the kinematics of the stars. So these are some examples of the galaxies that we picked. And in red, I show the MUSE field of view. So you can see we are looking really at the central region. So in this galaxy, we are not even covering the whole part of the bar. There's a lot of stuff still outside, but for other galaxies we cover the whole bar. We can see it here, you can even see the dust lanes here, but it's going to be clear in a few slides. So okay, so this is basically the field of view. So we are looking at the central region, which corresponds to a few kiloparsecs basically on average for our galaxies. This is basically an image color composite reconstructed from the MUSE data cube. So it's this basically from these central regions. What you can see with MUSE are these images here. So as I said, you could see the dust lanes with the gas coming down the bar, and this bluish structure in the center. And I can also create color maps from this from the MUSE data cube. This is what you see here. So darker shades correspond to red colors, and whiter shades correspond to bluer colors. So again, you can see the gas being brought to the center by the bar, and this image is, by the way, attest also the fantastic imaging capabilities of the instrument, which is a spectrograph. It's not a camera, it's a spectrograph, but it creates really good images, and you can see also the gas going really, really close to the central region. So I'm gonna just make a little detour here. Of course, when we were confronted with all this data, so it's basically 100,000 spectrum per galaxy. So we're talking about literally millions of spectra, and we wanted to study the kinematics and star formation histories of all these regions within these galaxies. We decided to develop a pipeline that we call the GIST pipeline. This was developed by my student Adrian Bittner. And this pipeline not only has a wrapper for all the analysis of the stellar kinematics and stellar populations and emission lines, but it also has this fantastic graphic interface where you can visualize the result of the fit. So basically, you have a data cube here, for example. This is a velocity map from one of our galaxies. You can click on any of the spatial bins where you did a spectral fit, and you can see the results of the fit for the different analysis, and you can check if the fits are good or not, and you can see the star formation history, the distribution of alpha over iron, metallicity, all this stuff. And this was fundamental to understand if the fits were good and to understand the limitations of the fits and how we could also overcome the limitations. For example, we did changes in the wavelength range that we are using for the spectral fits and the signal to noise that we were aiming for, also for the Voronoi beams when we were beaming the data. All of this was helped by the by this interface. So this is, of course, I'm saying all this because this is publicly available and there's a number of teams already using this interface. So let's have a look at the kinematic map. So basically, this is the one of the main results that we got. So here I'm showing for the two galaxies that we were looking before, a kinematic map. So remember, this is the central region of the galaxy. So this is the stellar velocity map within a few kiloparsecs. This is the velocity dispersion map. And this is maps of H3 and H4. So H3 and H4 are higher order moments of the line of sight velocity distribution. I'm going to tell a little bit about them in a minute. But basically what we are seeing, and these are two examples, but we are seeing essentially in all of our galaxies, is that in the central region, we find a rapidly rotating component that has low velocity dispersion. And we also find an anti-correlation between H3 and V. So here in this region that's rapidly rotating, you see red beams here where you see blue in the velocity. And when you see red in velocity, you see blue in H3. So this anti-correlation is an indication of near circular orbits. So a disk, basically. And we also see elevated values of H4. The same thing for this galaxy and basically all the galaxies. So, and this elevated value of H4 basically means that the component is not alone in the center, the stellar component. It's on top of something else. It's basically that there is a nuclear disk there that is on top of the main underlying disk of the galaxy. So let's have a quick look on what H3 and H4 are. So basically, we are fitting the line of sight velocity distribution at every spatial beam in the galaxy. So at every, with a spatial resolution of 100 parsecs, more or less, as a Gaussian, basically. So a pure Gaussian will look like something like this. But if you vary H3, you get these deformations in the Gaussian. So these are negative values of H3 and these are positive values of H3. So H3 are deformations which are asymmetric in the Gaussian. And basically, for example, if you look here, you see that there is a tail in velocities at negative velocities, and there is a sharp drop in the positive velocities. This sharp drop occurs when you have a disk, because you cannot a star cannot have velocities higher than the circular velocity, and therefore you see this sharp drop here when you have near circular orbits, because almost all the stars have velocities close to the circular orbit, but they can never pass this velocity. So you have this kind of effect, and this anti-correlation that I mentioned before. Now H4 measures deviations from a Gaussian that are symmetric. So if you have a negative H4, you have a Gaussian that has kind of like a flattened top. But if you have positive values of H4, you have a more peaked Gaussian. And in fact, you can see that you have some wings here. So basically, if you think of this as the distribution of velocities along the line of sight of the stars in your galaxy, basically it looks like you have two components. You have a component that has a high velocity dispersion and a component that has a low velocity dispersion, which is exactly what we are seeing there. So we have the nuclear disk that has a low velocity dispersion sitting on top of the underlying disk, which has high velocity dispersion. So that's why I said that an H4 indicates that that you have two components there. I also want to briefly mention the power of MUSE. So this is the same maps as observed with MUSE. Now you're seeing with MUSE, one of our maps, and the same galaxy, the same analysis done with Saurum data. So you can see that not only the the field of view is larger, but also the sensitivity and the spatial sampling are a lot better for MUSE. Is basically, if you use glasses like me, it's basically like putting your glasses on and you can see things a lot better. And this is why, you know, only now we can see the central regions of galaxies with this detail. Okay, so just to summarize this part, so these results show that the kinematical properties of these components in the center are all exactly as expected for bar-built nuclear disks. So the bar is putting gas slowly in the central region and forming a component that has a high support from rotation of the stars instead of random motion of the stars. In fact, you can make maps of V over sigma. So these are two other galaxies in our sample. So these are maps of V over sigma, and you can see clearly the nuclear disk showing up here. And you can also see that it's not just the inner part of the main disk, but it's a separate component, right? So you can see the main disk showing up here in the outer parts of our field. But it's disconnected from the nuclear disk. So it's a different, as an independent component. So the nuclear disk is, as I said again, is on top of the other structures that are present here. It's not just the inner part of the main nuclear disk, of the main galaxy disk. We can also look at V over sigma radio profile. So this you can see more sample wide. So basically, each panel here is a different galaxy in our sample. Let's focus on one panel only. So this is V over sigma as a function of radius. And each point here is one spatial beam in our data cubes. So you can see this is basically 4 or 5 kiloparsecs, 6 kiloparsecs from the center, you can see that the values of V over sigma are quite large because we are probing the main galaxy disk, and then they start decreasing when they go to the center. And if there was no nuclear disk, basically this will reach values close to zero. But when in the presence of the nuclear disk, there is a secondary peak, which is this peak here, and then after that it falls down again. So this we can see in all of our galaxies essentially, and this secondary peak in V over sigma. And this motivated us to also define a characteristic radius for the nuclear disk, which is the radius in which this peak occurs. And I will talk more about this radius in a minute. Also, we wanted to see if these structures appear as fast rotators in this very famous diagram where I'm plotting here the angular momentum within the radius of the nuclear disk, the kinematic radius, which is defined was the way I just said, so the peak of the V over sigma radio profile. So this is lambda within the kinematic radius of the nuclear disk as a function of the ellipticity of the central component. And this is a diagram that you certainly have seen being plotted for elliptical galaxies or early type galaxies, basically to identify galaxies that are slowly rotating, which would be below this dashed line here. And galaxies that are fastly rotating, which is occupying this locus here. And basically we find that our components are also fall in the locus where you expect to find fast rotators. So it's also a sanity check to make sure that everything is fitting well. So we can also study these structures now that we have established that these are nuclear disks as a family of structural components in galaxies. So here I show the distributions of V over sigma for this nuclear disk. So you see that they have values above one, so they are more supported by velocity than velocity dispersion. But they reach values quite close to one, and they don't reach very high values such as 5 or 10, which you find in main galaxy disks and outer parts of galaxy disks. So they are a little bit hotter than the main galaxy disks. And these are the distribution in size. So we reach sizes of 1 kiloparsec with a distribution from 100 to 1 kiloparsec more or less. And here the dashed line, I put the results that are found by one simulation by Cole and collaborators, where they basically simulate this process of the bar pushing gas to the center and triggering star formation and the formation of a new stellar component. And so they find this stellar component, and this is the size of their stellar component and the V over sigma of the stellar component. So it's what they are finding is corroborated with this data that we found, at least in these parameters. So now, of course, you can try to think of different ways in which this nuclear disk could have been formed. You could basically think that maybe, you know, in a flyby between two different galaxies, you can push gas towards the center, and this gas might accumulate and conserve angular momentum and form a nuclear disk without any interference from the bar. And this is in fact plausible, but we looked at other correlations, which I'm showing here, that you would only expect in the case of a bar-driven origin. So the first one is that there is a correlation between the kinematic radius of the nuclear disk and the bar size, which you see here. And there is also a correlation between this nuclear radius and the bar to total ratio. Okay, there is an outlier here that we have trouble explaining, but there is more or less a trend here that is consistent with the picture. And also very important is this anti-correlation here, or more like an anti-trend, because the correlation is not very strong, but there's a clear trend in which the largest nuclear disks are found in bars that are less eccentric, that are a little bit fatter, that are not very, very eccentric. And this is actually predicted by the bar-driven picture, because the nuclear disk cannot be wider than the bar itself. So you only have larger nuclear disk if the bar allows the disk to grow. So only wider bars, less eccentric bars, would allow nuclear disk that are bigger, and the narrower bars would only allow the formation of short nuclear disk. So basically, this is something that you would not expect if the bar had not had any role in this in this formation process. Another thing that is interesting to see from here is that basically the nuclear disk extends to about 10% of the bar length. This is also consistent with some models by Schlossmann et al. And now we find a problem here for the simulation of Cole et al, because basically they produce a nuclear disk in their simulation that is too large for the bar that they have in the simulation. So their nuclear disk is three times too large. So basically to fall outside of this diagram here. So this is something that we need to understand. Basically in simulations, we are reproducing some of the parameters that are observed, but not all of them. Okay, so now the other aspect that we wanted to understand, as I mentioned in the beginning, is that, you know, in photometry, people are finding different kinds of bulges. Bulges that have higher central concentration are so-called the classical bulges, and bulges that have an exponential profile or low central concentration are called pseudo bulges. So are these pseudo bulges the nuclear disks that we are seeing in the kinematic data? So basically here, just to remind you what the photometric decomposition does. So if you have a black line here, is the profile of the light profile of the galaxy, you decompose this into an exponential disk. And if you have a classical bulge, you would see something like this Cersic profile with a large Cersic index, like here is a Cersic index of 3. If it's a pseudo bulge, you find this kind of bulge has an exponential with a Cersic index 1. So basically, an exponential just as the main outer disk, but with a different size and with a different slope. So what we did is that we looked at careful decompositions that were done by the S4G team on the galaxies that we have in our sample. And basically we found that almost all of them, in fact, show the photometric bulge as an exponential bulge. So basically the nuclear disks that we are finding kinematically, they are finding also photometrically as an exponential bulge, disk-like bulge. Okay, so this is not to say that any photometric decomposition will, you know, find correctly what we are finding, like a nuclear disk, if they are going to find also an exponential bulge, because this depends a lot on the spatial resolution of the images and also on the models that are assumed in the decomposition. So this is very, very tricky. But if you do it carefully enough, you can recover this exponential bulges. But another test to see if really the exponential bulges are just nuclear disks is to look at the sizes that we find kinematically compared to the sizes that are found photometrically. So basically, what I'm plotting here is the distribution of the ratio between the kinematic radius of the nuclear disk that we find with the MUSE data cubes and the effective radius of the exponential bulges that are found photometrically. And what you see here is that they correlate, because basically they follow a normal distribution. This ratio follow a normal distribution in which also the standard deviation corresponds to, it's similar to the error that you find in the measurements of this sizes. So essentially, exponential photometric bulges are nuclear disks, and also we close the circle completely. We establish that these nuclear disks are built by bars, and these nuclear disks are what is called the pseudo bulge in photometric decompositions. So I have a few more slides about stellar orbits in bars. I'm going to go very quickly through this. We basically detected some signatures of that are expected for stellar orbits in bars in these kinematic maps. We also found signatures for the presence of bauxite peanuts in these kinematic maps. I don't have time to go into detail for this part, but you can ask me later. I want to show you a bit this gallery of V over sigma maps for almost all of our galaxies, just to show you that basically these nuclear disks are everywhere. So we found them in all of our galaxies, essentially. But I want to touch a little bit also on the stellar population properties. So we also derived stellar population properties for this nuclear disk. So these are maps of stellar age, metallicity, and alpha over ion. So you see, and we also find this for essentially all of our galaxies, that the mean stellar age is lower in the nuclear disk, the metallicity is higher, and the alpha over ion content is also low. So this is also consistent with the formation through a bar, so a bar-driven origin for the nuclear disk, because the bar will form stars here after the main underlying disk has been formed, so the stars are younger. The stars will be metal-rich also because of the same reason. And because the process is a relatively slow process, the bar is pushing gas to the center in a long time scale, you also have a low alpha over ion content here. So it's all consistent. In fact, we can plot also here radio profiles of age, metallicity, and alpha over ion for these nuclear disk components. And what we find is that the slope of these gradients, if you look at the average values, is continuous from the center until the end of the nuclear disk, which is denoted by this dashed line here. So the age gradually decreases from the center towards the end of the nuclear disk and then starts increasing again. Similar for the metallicity and for the alpha ion, and also the average value with radius increases from the center to the outer part of the nuclear disk and then remains more or less flat. So this suggests that actually these nuclear disks are basically dominating all the way to the center of the galaxy. They are not just in the central region like in a ring like shape, but they're going all the way to the central region. And this was a bit puzzling because basically when the bar pushes gas to the center, the region where this gas accumulates and forms stars is not necessarily goes all the way to the center of the galaxy, but basically follows a disk-like structure, which you can see actually here in NGC 1097. You can see we have a bar elongated in this direction. This shows the gas falling towards the center, and this nuclear ring, nuclear spiral arms, are showing where the star formation is happening. This is like, you know, you can see bluish stars here. So this is where the gas is piling up and forming new stars. So how can you form a nuclear disk that goes all the way to the center if the gas is accumulated in a ring-like structure, which is a few hundred parsecs from the center? So basically, we looked at simulations, and we see that the radius of the nuclear ring, so the radius in which the pileup of gas happens, depends on the length of the bar, correlates with the length of the bar. That's why also we have this correlation that I've shown before. However, bars were, appear to grow longer in time, at least they do this in simulation. So this means that these radius should also grow in time. So if you think that when the bar just formed, maybe the radius is closer to the center. So we can have the gas pushing gas closer to the center. And as the bar evolves and grows longer, this radius increases, and then the pile up of gas happens at successively larger radii. So if you have this sequence happening in time, you basically form a continuous nuclear disk via a series of concentric nuclear rings. So it's an inside-out formation, which is also consistent with these gradients that we're finding here. So the oldest stars appear in the center, and then they go younger in time, because the disk is forming inside out. So this is the formation scenario that we put forward for these nuclear disks. And another intriguing result is it concerns classical bulges, because we basically did not find in any of our galaxy signatures of a hot dominant central spheroid in the center. So basically, we're finding nuclear disks in all galaxies, but there's no classical bulge in our galaxies, which is a bit puzzling, because these galaxies are massive. The range of mass is basically around the Milky Way mass, but goes even a few times 10 to the 11 solar masses. So they're expected to have an active merger history, which would lead to the formation of classical bulges. So we don't understand completely why we are not seeing any classical bulge. Of course, this is a biased sample, right? Because we selected this sample to have bars and to have structures that are similar to disks in the center, but this doesn't prevent that you can have a nuclear disk, a bar, and a classical bulge in the same galaxy. This is, in principle, completely plausible, but we don't find any such classical bulge in our sample. So this may or may not be a challenge to Lambda CDM, most likely not, but this can help us to understand other processes in the formation of galaxies, and possibly feedback processes can be preventing the formation of classical bulges in barred galaxies, where we actually find the formation of a nuclear disk instead. So I'm coming to the end of my talk, and just let me close this circle again and go back to the Milky Way. So as I said, these galaxies that we selected for the timer sample are Milky Way-like galaxies. They are barred spirals like the Milky Way, and with similar masses. So does the Milky Way have a nuclear disk, as these galaxies do? So it looks that indeed this is the case. The evidence is difficult to obtain, of course, because we are inside the Milky Way, and there is a lot of dust extinction towards the central region. But there are papers such as Launhardt et al. In 2002 that doing star counts, and also Sormani et al. More recently, they conclude that there is a rapidly rotating structure in the center of the Milky Way disk, which is coplanar with the Milky Way disk, and has a radius between 100 and 200 parsecs. A scale height of 45 parsecs, so it's quite thin. And in fact, there is also a gaseous outer edge in this nuclear disk, which is basically where the bar is pushing gas and piling up gas. And this is what is called the central molecular zone. And it has an estimated mass of about 7 × 10⁸ solar masses. So basically consistent, generally consistent with our observations. But there are still some challenging results from these works. For example, Sormani et al. Report that the velocity dispersion in the vertical direction of the nuclear disk in the Milky Way is larger than the velocity dispersion in the radial direction, which is difficult to understand in comparison to our results. We show a more thinner ellipsoid of the velocity dispersion. So it's basically the disk that Sormani et al. Is reporting in the center of the Milky Way has some kinematics that is not consistent with our results. But this remains to be confirmed. Of course, as I said, studying the Milky Way central region is difficult, especially in the plane of the Milky Way disk. So this brings me towards the end. So these are stay-home messages, right? Because everybody's at home. So basically, the main result is that the kinematics, the stellar kinematics, and the stellar population properties of the central regions of barred galaxies are consistent with a picture in which bars produce or build a nuclear stellar disk because of the bar-driven evolution. And this contrasts with the merger-driven formation of classical bulges. So now this difference between the classical bulge and the so-called disk-like bulge is well understood in terms of kinematics, not only in terms of photometry. And we also show that indeed these exponential disk-like bulges that are found in photometric studies are rotationally supported nuclear disks. And in fact, we could even stop calling them pseudo-bulges and just call them nuclear disks. And this nuclear disk seems to extend all the way to the center of the galaxy and to form from inside out. And they appear ubiquitously in Milky Way type galaxies, as you've seen in all of our samples. We found these nuclear disks, and the Milky Way also appears to have a nuclear disk. So I will stop here and thank you very much. I'll be happy to take questions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for this great talk. I will start with a very simple question myself. This bar structure arises from instability, gravitational instability, right? So right. You mentioned that only 2/3 of the galaxies is shown a bar. What happens with the other?
That's a very good question. It's not clear. So in fact, we need to understand. One possibility is that, as I said, the bars are formed due to a gravitational instability, and this gravitational instability appears if the disk is cold enough. So if the velocity, if the rotational support of the disk is strong enough, if the disk is a little bit hot, if the velocity dispersion, for example, if the velocity dispersion of the stars in the disk is above a certain threshold, in comparison to the circular velocity of the stars, then these hotter disks might not develop bars. So this is a possibility. Another possibility is that if you have, we expect that all these galaxies have a dark matter halo. And so the dark matter halo can do two things with the formation of a bar. It can delay the formation of the bar. So if you have a massive dark matter halo, you can prevent the formation of the bar. But once the bar forms, then the dark matter halo does the other way around. It makes the bar grow stronger. Mm-hmm. But in the phase before the formation of the bar, this dark matter halo can be preventing the formation of the bar. So we need to understand why this other third or 20% of galaxies don't have bars. And these are two possible clues that need to be looked at.
Okay, thank you. It's very, very interesting. So let's move on with this queue of questions here. So let's move on with Elizabeth Bech. You can ask your question.
Oi, Dimitri. Tudo bem? Aqui é Bech falando.
Tudo bom, Bech?
Okay. Let me ask you one question with regard to the formation of the nuclear disk. Is there any information at all on the on a correlation of the formation of these disks with the nuclear activity, or in other words, this sample of galaxies that you studied, are they active galaxies as well, or with an evidence of a black hole in the center, or not at all? They are just regular disk bar shaped galaxies.
So that's also a very good question, because when we selected the sample, we didn't even look at whether they have AGN or not. And right. It turned out that all but one have AGN. Now, of course, so basically what I mean, there has been a lot of studies trying to connect the bars pushing gas to the center and
the
AGN activity, right? Mm-hmm. Because it looks like a natural way to feed the black hole. But there are contradictory results, and basically there are many difficulties, because basically the bar is able to push gas to a region that's say a few tens of parsecs from the black hole, but beyond that, so in the final parsecs, other processes have to take place to keep removing angular momentum from the gas. So what my understanding, so the way
fields. Magnetic fields are helpful.
Yeah, absolutely. Viscosity of the gas, I agree. And so my understanding is that the bar builds a reservoir of gas close to the central region, and then something else has to, you know, complete the final step. So there are, you can find an excess of AGN in barred galaxies, but it's not a clear-cut case. It's not that all AGN have a bar, because you can also fuel AGN with a merger, and also not all barred galaxies. The other thing is that the time scales are very different, right? So the bar stays basically forever in the disk, and the AGN is more episodic. So you might look at a galaxy when the AGN is off, even though the bar pushed gas to the center and helped igniting the AGN in another stage. So to find these correlations is difficult because of all these difficulties. So as I said, my understanding is that the bar helps, and then other processes, as you said, magnetic fields, gas viscosity, other processes contribute to the final parsecs to bring the gas to the black hole.
Right. Can I make another question? Yeah, because you said, okay, you have 1/3 is bulge and 2/3 bar-like, right? Nevertheless, is there any chance? And then you said, okay, it was amazing that we didn't see any galaxies in our sample with the two, with the bar and the bulge as well, right? And a little bulge in the center, something like that, right? Mm-hmm. Is there any possibility of bulges really to form at late stages because I know bars are very stable, but still you have this accretion of stars and gas towards the center, and eventually this angular momentum removal, complete removal, may help to build a bulge with the dispersion velocities higher than the rotational velocities, right? Is there any chance of an evolutionary picture like this, or is simply that the bars are so stable during the Hubble time that there is no evidence of an evolution of a bar-like hint for this, a trend for this? Is there any possibility?
So I think from a completely theoretical perspective, I think that this could happen, right? You could have a barred galaxy like the ones that we were studying, and if you have a minor merger, in the right orbital configuration, you can imagine that you can produce.
No, I'm not saying with an external agent.
You mean with a bar itself?
As time goes by, you have all this, you know, this process of accretion and the removal of angular momentum, and eventually you end up with a nuclear bulge rather than a nuclear disk, and then the whole picture.
It's difficult because the bar is in the plane of the galaxy, right, with this galaxy, so the gas will always come within the plane and form stars, that the range in radial motion in the vertical direction, for example, is going to be very limited, so this will be difficult. If you look at the orbital dynamics of barred galaxies in the central region, the regular orbits are more circular, they are not so elongated, so you know, if you push gas there, you form stars that will remain in this less elongated orbits, so it's difficult to form a classical bulge, really, a structure that has less less rotational support than random motion support. Mind you that our nuclear disks, they are not super, I mean, some of them are not super rotational support, right? They have a V over sigma of just above one. But below one, I think this is going to be very difficult. In fact, there is a work in which they found the other way around of what you're saying, that you can start, so this simulation work also, you can start with a disk and a classical bulge, so a disk and a central spheroid, and you develop a bar, and because the bar rotates, in this work, they find, it still needs more confirmation, more work, but in this work, they find that the hot spheroid starts to accelerate in rotation because of the potential of the bar.
Right.
Mm-hmm. So it gains a little more rotational support rather than random motion support.
Right. Mm-hmm. Okay. So it does make sense. Thanks a lot, Dimitri. Nice talk. Very interesting.
Thank you.
And good luck there.
Thanks.
Okay. I thought we had a question from Juan, but I'm not sure it's...
Oh, the thing is that the question was already asked by Becci. So it was related to what is the influence of the bars and the growth of the supermassive black hole. But I think you already discussed in the previous answer.
Thank you. So, Reinaldo?
Hey, Dimitri. Thanks for the talk. I was interested in one information you told us in the beginning. If you understood correctly, if you have the presence of an old nuclear disk, so it means that the galaxy did not suffer major mergers during its evolution, right? At least in the recent history of the galaxy. I would like to know about the sensitivity of this, how major merger it has to be. Minor mergers could also destroy this nuclear disk or the bar. So the galaxy could cannibalize small galaxies and still keep this nuclear disk.
Yeah, so I don't have an answer to that. I think also we don't know so well, because this would require, you know, systematic studying different mergers with different mass ratios, different orbital configurations to understand that. So it's difficult to say, you know, it's a ratio of three, below three, you destroy the nuclear disk. I don't know. But minor mergers probably would not have an effect. If you say a ratio of 10 or more, in the mass of the galaxies that they do not have a significant effect. But it's not only about the mass ratio, but also how the merger happens, right? Because if the cannibalized galaxy contributes only to the halo, the stellar halo on the outer parts, then nothing happens to the central region. The bar and the nuclear disk will remain there, stable. Now, if you have a head-on collision, even if it's a small galaxy, but goes through the center of the massive galaxy, then probably you can create havoc there and destroy the nuclear disk. So it depends. It depends a bit on the configuration. It's difficult to pinpoint.
Exactly. I understand. It is still missing some, as you said, a systematic statistical study.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, Professor Laerte, pode fazer sua pergunta?
Thank you, Dimitri, for this nice talk. I was wondering what would be the minimum mass for a disk to be able to develop a bar? Because I suspect that there are many dwarfs that are disk-like objects, but they don't show any clear evidence of a bar. Probably there is a minimum stellar mass or something like that. Do you know something about it?
Yeah, so very good question too. Definitely for the bar instability to develop, you need a certain the self-gravitation of the disk has to be enough, right? So the mass has to be enough. If the mass is too low, the formation of the bar might be more difficult. So I don't know what the value is, but that goes in the right direction, what you're saying. And another thing to take into account also is what I mentioned before, is that if the dark matter halo is dominant over the baryonic mass, the formation of the bar will be delayed. So it could be that the dwarf galaxy that you're seeing now is disk-like and doesn't have a bar is because the dark matter halo is preventing the formation of the bar, at least for some time. And as the Large Magellanic Cloud has a bar, which might have been actually triggered by the interaction with the Milky Way, because also interactions and flybys can trigger the formation of the bar if it doesn't develop by itself. Mm-hmm. So there's all these things to consider. But yeah, there are dwarf galaxies that are barred, but yeah, I mean, many of them don't have. Maybe the fraction is larger in dwarf galaxies, which wouldn't make sense. I mean, in fact, the papers that I was showing before, they're showing that it changes with mass. So there's more, the fraction of barred galaxies is higher, the more massive galaxies. And this could be because it takes time to form the bar, and the dark matter halo delays the formation of the bar for the lower mass galaxies.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I have one last question regarding the material that is piled up by the effect of the bar. I am wondering what are the conditions of this material? Is this highly compressed? Is it heated? It's not clear for me.
Well, I mean, this will be molecular clouds, basically. So more or less same conditions that you find in molecular clouds. I'm trying to think now if there will be shocks. Also, there something that we could look with the BPT diagrams. There are certainly shocks when in the leading edges of the bar.
Mm-hmm.
So when the gas, because actually it's very interesting, the gas is actually in the disk is rotating faster than the bar. So the gas crosses the bar and then comes back because of the gravitational potential of the bar, and then shocks with the other masses of gas that are coming still. Yeah. So there are shocks in this region, and then the gas loses angular momentum and start falling down. And then when it reaches the center, I don't know if there are shocks or not, but basically the conditions are, this will be easy to see. I just don't know, but basically the conditions will be similar to molecular cloud, because this will eventually form stars. And in fact, we one paper we did recently with this data that we were not expecting to do, and because we in one of these rings, it's a shame that I don't have a slide to show that, but in one of these rings, we there's so much star formation that you can see bubbles of warm gas coming out of the nuclear ring, which is basically stellar feedback, right? Mm-hmm. And so there, of course, there are shocks, and you can see that this warm gas is pushing cold gas. There's also ALMA data for the same galaxy, so we can see shocks between the warm and cold gas in this region of the nuclear ring. And we also seen something that Betty would like to hear. I don't know if she left, maybe, but I can send her an email later. We also seen the effects of magnetic fields actually in this region. Basically, because we were trying to understand how the cold gas remains cold in this violent region where this warm gas colliding at high speeds. And one of the preferred scenarios is that actually magnetic fields are actually keeping this cold gas together and not you know, letting it burst apart. I can send you the link later if you want.
Yes, please. This is really fascinating. So you see that even though you are not sure if you would have a shock in the center, you definitely have a shock because of this receding material that will collide with the infalling one.
Yeah.
Another question I would have is that this pileup will trigger star formation, but will it trigger also outside when it's let's say not really in the center, but during, let's say, the accretion, you see also the triggering star formation in this.
No, and we think we kind of understand why is because of shearing, basically because when the gas is falling, you know, along the bar, the velocity, there's a gradient in the velocity of the gas perpendicular to the bar, so the gas will be falling faster than other molecular clouds, so that basically they don't lose energy and agglomerate. They will just basically go down, and because of this shearing effect, stars are not formed. The molecular clouds do not collapse and stars are not formed.
Exactly, yeah. And that's very interesting. Thank you so much. So I thank you again, the speaker, Dimitri, many thanks for this great talk. And
thank you
for all the discussion. And I will thank everyone who is following. And I will ask Richard to stop the transmission whenever he comes.